Good morning, everyone. Is the screen visible?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes.
Recording started. Can you see?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, fine. Because I'm in the full view, I could not see the other tabs. Okay, let us start with the deep learning topic. So let us start with what is deep learning and what are the applications of deep learning. So here, deep learning can be implemented only using a neural network. And by deep, it refers to the number of layers in the network. Actually, it is a multi-layer perceptron, like what we have seen, a single layer perceptron and a backpropagation network. Similar to that, this has multiple hidden layers in between the input and the output layer. So the number of layers refers to the depth or deep in the network. So basically, this is also a kind of a subset of machine learning where we can perform the prediction or classification. And this neural network architecture, which performs a classification that involves multiple hidden layers, can take mainly four different types of inputs. That means an image, a video, an audio file, and then a text file. So mainly we can use these four inputs only, the data, and whether it is an image or video or sound or text, whatever it is basically converted to a numerical data, and the numerical data from all these inputs will be going to the network as the inputs. So in the input, actually, it can be from a sensor. That means you can take a live capturing from a input video. Say somebody is standing at a security gate or at a surveillance, you want to see whether he is an employee or a stranger or a visitor. So in that case, there will be a camera which is capturing the image of a person, and then the features of a person can be extracted and it can be classified into one of these categories. Okay, so that is again a sensor which is capturing the image or a video and it goes to the network. So an input need not come from your hard disk or from your pen drive, the image or a sound or a video or a text. It can come from a sensor also. So your input can be of any of the modalities. So how the companies use CNNs, that means the convolution neural network. So I will be giving a brief explanation on why we need a convolution and why this deep learning is called as a convolution neural network. Basically, the data is very important. That is the new fuel, we say. The data, that means you see a music recommender system or anything. Suppose you watch your YouTube, your favorite channels that you have subscribed, or randomly you're watching some movies based on the genre what you watch. The subsequent kind of movies will be popping up. Suppose you are watching a stand-up comedy show, once or twice you will be watching, and then the subsequent popping up for you to watch further will be on the same kind. Suppose you are watching a music, then the music will be coming, or a cookery show, then the same thing will be coming. So basically the YouTube, it actually stores every video with some tag name and then with what category it belongs to. So once when you click on one particular movie and start watching, those keywords what you have seen associated with will be searched, and the rest of the things will be prompted for you to watch like that. In the same way, whatever you place order in Swiggy, Zomato, everything is like that, prompting you to buy something, especially in Amazon. You will be seeing advertisements in YouTube or when you open internet, it is basically money marketing, and then Amazon everywhere. In Amazon, if you buy a chair, then the next time what you are looking for will be prompting similar to that. Okay, So basically, it is actually the feature that is extracted or the data, what you are looking for, what you are interested will be extracted. Okay. So the object recognition we can perform using deep learning. So we need several images to perform the training and the prediction or the classification. So at real time, we can perform by giving an input through a webcam. And then we can perform detection and localization. See, there are a couple of differences between detection and recognition. Detection means you are just identifying. Recognition means you are recognizing this is so and so. Suppose you are in the first image, there is a car, you are just detecting a car. When you say recognition, you are recognizing whether it is a BMW or a Maruti, whatever it is. So detection means you are just finding a car. Recognizing means what car it is. Suppose you are doing a face recognition means, suppose if people faces are there, say suppose Priya, myself, Jyotsna, Sahana, so many people faces are there. If all faces are in images are there, then we can recognize, we can draw a bounding box and detect the faces. But to whom this face belongs to, if you perform, then that is called recognition. Okay. And then localization means where it is in particular coordinate within the image, that now this car is in the center. Sometimes you want to identify a tree which is in the right top corner. So you are trying to perform a kind of a localization where it is. And segmentation means you have to identify it from the background and separate it. Maybe you want to find with what speed it is going, or you want to eliminate the background and pick up only this. Say for example, in a surveillance, if it is an unmanned aerial vehicle that is capturing the motion picture, then the speed at which the vehicle that it is tracking, all those it has to follow. So the background is not required. So there are several situations like this. Similarly, we can use some signals also, like music or any other signal. We can perform that. Say, for example, a speech recognition we can perform. That means you, when you say speech, actually there are two things. One is using the words, you can try what is the spoken word that is using the vocabulary or that one. Another one is the vocal information. That means the pitch, the modulation, actually we call that as entropy information. So based on that also, we can try to find what emotions the person is expressing, whether angry or fear or sad or happy, depending on the way in which a particular word is pronounced. Okay, LSTM is long short-term memory. We will be discussing later. And food classifier, classification. So how many ever classes you have, we can classify. And from the input data, there could be millions of images from which you can perform the training. And then you can show what class it is predicted. Basically, only few lines of code we need to do. I'm showing it from the MATLAB window. The same thing can be performed using Python. And this MNIST is a very standard data set. This is created for digits recognition numbers. So if you want to extract the handwritten digits, perform number plate detection or any other numbers detection, you can use this data set. So we usually detect what number it is. Say in the prescription or in anywhere, if you want to predict the number, then this can be used. So here, once again, what we are doing is we are detecting, we are recognizing, and also we are segmenting, then we are classifying. Okay. And similarly, the speech, whether you want to detect the words or based on the pronunciation, the pitch and the speech signal input, are you finding the emotions or what words? You can also perform speaker recognition based on the each person's voice. and how can things work with audio? So based on the signals, you transform the signal and perform the convolution, then match it with the target labels and get a model, train it to get a model, then perform testing. So we will be discussing about this architecture. Similarly, classification of speakers using LSTM. Who is speaking? That means based on the, we have to give the individual sample, voice audio samples of the speaker. Then you have to extract the information that that will recognize the speaker individually. With those features, you have to perform the classification. And for text generation, this is mainly using the LSTM. Alexa, Siri, all those uses these kind of a deep learning part, LSTM, etc. You can predict, you can do the image captioning. Suppose if a dog is jumping, then by seeing the picture, you can write a sentence, the dog is jumping, okay? So text generation we can do. So there are a lot of procedure involved in it. You have to take the input from the Word document or a text file, and then there are, I think you guys are learning NLP, so you have to find the stop words and then stem words, tokenizing, all those operations you have to perform, and then you have to perform the conversion from the text to the numeric, and then you have to develop a model for finding what word it is or what sentence it is, etc. So now let us move on to the approaches of deep learning. Basically, there are only two approaches for deep learning, your network development or a model development. The first one is train a deep neural network from scratch. That means you yourself or the designer can develop a network model from the input to the output. In between all the hidden layers, you can decide, and then what will be the input size, I mean the layer size, how many neurons based on the number of inputs, and how many neurons in the hidden layer, and how many hidden layers you need, and then the output layer, how many classes I'm going to classify. If I'm classifying four classes like this, then in my classifier, I will have only four classes. If I'm having 10 classes, then how will I modify it to classify 10 classes? All that the user or the designer will have the freedom to do it. So that is a train a deep neural network from scratch. Usually we will call it as develop from the scratch. That is one approach where end to end, the user will develop their own network model. And the next one is called a transfer learning model. So what we do here is there are already some pre-trained models like AlexNet or VGGNet, there are ResNet. There are so many models that have been developed and they are open source. So in that, what is actually being made is the hidden layers and how the convolution or feature extraction happens, all are being well-defined or predefined. What we need to do is you have to only modify the last layer. That means you have to customize the classification part only to suit to the number of classes that you are going to classify, okay? If you are classifying four classes, then modify the last layer for classifying into four. Similarly, for 10 or six, whatever. So in case of transfer learning, what you do is you take a pre-trained model, modify only the classification layer, and then combine it and then make it as a new model which is suiting to your need. You can do a customization that way also. Okay, that means because the standard models are tested and they are working in a very fine way, so you can just take it, it's like a plug and play. You can just take it, change only the last layer to suit your number of classes for classification, and then you can go ahead. That is very easy. And for your project, I prefer, or myself and Jyotsna ma'am, we prefer everyone to do the first model. That means develop your own layer from the scratch. And now this is the convolution part. So I stop the presentation here, and then I will go to another presentation where I will be explaining why we need convolution and what happens in a convolution, and then again we'll come back here. So I will just quickly explain this slide. So here, when we give an input image, first what happens is the features, basically all of you know, in case of any pattern recognition problem or classification problem, right from the beginning, we know we need to extract the features, and the extracted features have to be put in a proper vector form or in an array form, and it should be given to a classifier for classification. So the extraction of features, first of all, you have to decide what features. If it is a salmon seabass classification, then length and width of the fish. Suppose if it is fruits, then it apple and orange means, then it is the color and texture and not size. Suppose if it is orange, gooseberry and pepper or lemon, then it is color and the size. So depends on what you want to classify, you will be deciding on the features, then extract the features from the image or from the input data. And then if the number of features are more, and if the accuracy is less, if you feel many irrelevant features are there, then you need to do a dimensionality reduction, then you have to go for the classification. Okay, so this, the first part from the input, extracting the features, this part is called as feature learning. Why it is not called as feature extraction means, we are extracting features. And why we are associating the term learning here is, we are making the network to learn for the target object with the features extracted. A mapping we are trying to do. That means what we are doing in the mapping is, we are training the model, network model, with the weights. We are modifying the weights throughout the back propagation, and in the Hebb's rule or in simple perceptron we have seen, the weights are being updated in the learning process. The learning is a continuous process till the network is trying to find a match for the input data in the target class. Okay, correct. So till then, the weights are being updated, and that is called as learning. So in the feature learning, the feature extraction and then the weight updation, everything happens. So this is called as a feature learning part. And then once if the learning is done, then the classification is done. So we will be doing in detail about what is the learning, what is happening in the learning, and what is happening in the classification. Okay. So now I'll move on to a topic, why we need convolution, why not the normal feature extraction using a neural network. So there should be some motivation for us to use a convolution concept here instead of a multi-layer perceptron. In case of a multi-layer perceptron, for example, we have seen the back propagation method and then a simple perceptron method. So in that, what happens is, these neurons are connected to this hidden layer or the output layer, whatever it may be. Now the only these layers are connected to the input, and these layers are zeros, let us assume. Okay, I mean the input to these input neurons are zero, and only these four inputs you are giving the, I mean input neurons, you are giving the values of the image, the pixel values of the image, and then the weights are multiplied with this input, and then you are trying to get an output here. If it is a cat, it has to predict one, let us say. If this is not a cat, it has to predict zero, let us say like that. Okay, so now the cat image, the inputs goes only to a portion of this input neurons, and then the weights associated with those neurons are getting revised or altered in every iteration in the process of making the output neuron one. Okay. Now, next, let us see what happens. Suppose I am giving the input image here. That means these input neurons receive the pixel intensity values. So now these weights, these four weights will be updated. Okay. Now let us see what is the problem with this. Suppose while testing, this is my training part. I give a testing where I keep my cat image in the center. That means I give it for a different set of inputs. Then what happens? A combination of this red and green set of neurons I am giving the cat input. In that case, what happens? If it is this case, then only these four weights are being set right to give a output one. If I'm using this, only these four weights are matched to get a output one. Whereas if I keep it somewhere here in a combination of red and green, then the system is going to fail miserably. Okay. That means if you give the input in any place, it will not work. But we want the neural network to learn properly wherever I give the input image to any neuron. If I give my input image, that means the intensity values of the image is given to any input neuron, the neural network should extract the features, update the weight automatically in a training process, and then it should give me a one. Okay. So that is why the MLP failed, because the connections are fixed and the operation of XI into WI is also fixed. Okay. This is the reason that we are going for a convolution operation and not a simple MLP. Okay. So the convolution is going to help us, and I will come back to this convolution once again. But before that, I want to explain another concept. Three reasons why we need to use convolution. Okay. The first reason is the sparse connectivity. That means in an MLP, we have seen it is many to many connection. That means all the input neurons are connected to all the neurons of the hidden layer or output layer. And then from the hidden layer one to hidden layer two also, all the neurons are connected to each other. It is many to many combination. So, in case of a deep learning architecture, what we are doing is we are not doing that way. Instead, it is only very few connections are made. That means a sparse connectivity is made to whichever neuron we want to pass on or communicate the information. Then only those neurons are connected. And also the parameter sharing happens instead of many to many. All the neurons receiving all the information from all the inputs or hidden layer neurons, we are only giving a specific neurons communicating to specific neurons in the next layer and subsequent layer and so on. So the parameter sharing will be limited. The third reason is equivariant representation. This equivariant representation I will explain a bit later. When I explain the other slide. And before that, I will go on to this slide also. Can you see an image which is being rotated? Here we have an image. We are rotating the image by an angle 25 degree. So it is rotated in an anti-clockwise direction. So when we rotate an image, what happens is, we are not changing any of the intensity information, only its spatial coordinates. The x and y position are being altered, but the intensity which were present in the same position of the location of the image continues to remain in the same place. Okay, this point you please keep it in mind. So when you perform any spatial transformation, there is no change to the intensity. We are not doing any intensity transformation. So similarly, we can perform a translation. That means an image can be moved from left to right or right to left, top to bottom, anywhere you can perform a translation. Okay. And image scaling. That means the top one, you are making it equi-sized, double the times you are doing. And the bottom one, you are only expanding, scaling in one dimension. You are not scaling in the other dimension. Okay. So this is scaling. Once again, there is no change to the intensity. This kind of transformation is called as geometric transformation. The next is shear. In shear, we can perform a kind of a sliding. Like if assume the image is having number of layers, and or you assume a stack of papers you are keeping vertically, and you just give a light push from the left side, all the papers will be pushing like a layers moving, isn't it? So that way it is happening. This is called horizontal because you are moving from left to right. Similarly, you can do a vertical. In that case, the shear will happen on the other direction. Okay, so these are the various geometrical transformation. So translation, rotation, scaling, shear, etc. Okay, so now I will come to the convolution part, and then I will explain you the equivariant also. So here I would like to use the board now to explain what is convolution and also two types of operations. Okay. So I will first show in the slide. So here, this is the input image. We have 1001 that is being shown separately here. This is called as an image patch or a local receptive field. That means some